You are listening to the Hiking Radio Network, where we talk the walk with shows by hikers about hikers for everybody.
Welcome to the Trail Dames podcast, where we speak with women who love to dance upon this earth. So, you know, on this show, we meet so many amazing women, women who are changing the world and putting good out there and doing extraordinary things. And sometimes we also share men who are doing the exact same thing. So I have to tell you, the guy that's on the show today, his name is Bowen Blair. And I learned about him because he just wrote a book. His book is called A Force for Nature. It's a story of Nancy Russel and her fight to save the Columbia Gorge. Now, if you've never heard this story, you are going to love this. I had never heard any of it. I didn't know any of it. Nancy Russel was a woman that, unfortunately, she passed away a little while ago, but she lived in the Columbia Gorge. She lived it. She loved it. And she dedicated her life to fighting to save it from development. And she did it. She had no history of advocacy or experience in that kind of thing. She just jumped in one day and said, I'm going to make this happen. And her story is amazing. When I finished learning about her, I was so excited. I was like reading about her and reading about Bowen, who wrote this book. And I'm like, I have got to meet this woman. Maybe after I interview Bowen, she'll come on. And that's when I learned that she had passed away. And it literally, like, my heart squeezed when I read the dates. And I was like, oh, you know, do you ever come across somebody that you read about and you just genuinely hurt that you didn't get to meet them in real life? Well, that's how I felt about Nancy. And I'm so grateful. Bowen is coming on today, and he's going to, like, let us see into her life and what she did and just the amazing change that she affected up in Portland. And let me tell you, Bowen has actually done all the same work. He just does it more quietly. And so both of them, learning about them and listening to Bowen, I think you're going to really, really love this. My name is Anna. All my friends call me Mudbutt. And today you're listening to a really cool episode of the Trail Dames podcast. Bowen, thank you so much for being on the show. I'm really excited to talk to you today.
Well, thank you, Anna. It's great to be on. I'm intrigued by your organization, so thank you very much.
Well, I tell you, I think that, you know, the story that you're here to share today, first of all, anyone would love it and anyone would be completely inspired. But our listeners are going to be extra much so inspired because our listeners tend to they love seeing people go out and do good in this world, whether they're prepared to do it or whether they're went to school for it. And, you know, today, you know, you wrote a book and you're sharing the story of Nancy Russel. And she, from everything I already read, from the stuff you shared with me, she is a person that just went out and did big good in this world.
She did. And she did it despite a lot of adversity. And she did it for all the right reasons. I mean, she really wanted people to know the Columbia Gorge, to be able to come in and enjoy it. So, you know, it was such a privilege for me to work with her for some 25 years. It couldn't have been better. And it inspired me. She inspired me to write the book.
All right. So for our listeners that don't know who Nancy was, tell everybody about her and what she did.
Yeah. Nancy was a woman who had four children. She lost a fifth child as a toddler under tragic circumstances. She lived in Portland, Oregon. She loved the outdoors. She was recruited to the fight to protect the Columbia Gorge by an architect, an internationally known architect called John Yon. And she embarked on this crusade. And in many respects, it really was a crusade. The first effort to protect the gorge happened in 1916. And every generation afterwards, there was an effort to protect the gorge. In 1916, they tried to create a national park. In the 1930s, it was an interstate park proposed by John Yon. In the 1950s, Oregon and Washington started separate gorge commissions to manage the area, but they were advisory only, so they accomplished little. And in 1970, John Yon proposed a national recreation area. But all of those efforts went nowhere, and they went nowhere for a combination of federal territoriality. The Forest Service didn't want to see the Park Service manage an area where it had a presence. There were private enterprises that didn't want to have any regulation of the work that they were doing. So for a variety of reasons, those efforts never went anywhere. And in 1980, when Nancy started her work in the Columbia Gorge, that was really going to be it. If the gorge wasn't going to be protected in the 1980s, it was going to be lost. And the reason for that was a new interstate went in really about a few miles from the western entrance of the gorge. And that connected downtown Portland to unzoned lands in Skamania County that mostly were farmlands and ranches high above the Columbia, 1,000 feet or more above the Columbia. So they offered premium sites for residential development. There was a large area right at the entrance to the gorge in Clark County that, unlike Skamania County, was zoned, but it was zoned for heavy industry. And this was right at the entrance to the gorge. So if Russel didn't protect the gorge in the 1980s, we would have had factories at its entrance. We would have had the beautiful and historic farms and ranches in the western gorge lost to residential development. And there were a host of other development efforts. But that was what was facing Russel. And the only solution really was federal legislation, because the gorge is such a large, complex area. It's about 85 miles long. It consists of 2 states, 6 counties, 2 national forests, 2 federal dams, an interstate, a state highway. So it was incredibly complex. We needed federal legislation to pass, but Russel was up against this history of 70 years of efforts being crushed. And at that point, in 1980, she had both governors, Oregon and Washington, opposed to federal legislation. She had 5 of the 6 counties opposed to federal legislation. She had most of the gorge's 41,000 residents opposed to federal legislation. And she had President Reagan, who was just elected, very much opposed to federal legislation. He appointed James Watt as Secretary of the Interior. Watt immediately put a moratorium on the purchase of new federal parklands, and then he proposed selling off 35 million acres of the federal domain. So that's what faced Russel.
So in other words, you know, some people have friends in high places. So she had enemies in very high places.
That she did.
So let's go back to the beginning, though. Well, first of all, you call her Russel. Is that what you always call her? Is that what everyone called her?
No, you know, I call her Nancy most of the time, but just kind of to lend a little bit of detachment, often I call her Russel.
Okay.
But, you know, we were pretty close, and I worked with her for 25 years, so I called her Nancy.
Gotcha. I was going to say, you know, in all honesty, here at Trail Dames, we don't do detachment very well. And one of the things I love about this is what I think, because from what I read, it looks like you met her and that y'all did become great friends. That's what it looked like, that you worked together a lot. Is that the case?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she interviewed me and hired me. It was one of those awkward interviews where we had 15 board members, Nancy and myself, and Nancy asked most of the questions, so I knew where the power was. And we ended up, You know, I worked with her for 6 years as executive director of Friends of the Columbia Gorge, which was the organization she started to protect the gorge. Then I worked with her for 20 years as a senior vice president of the Trust for Public Land, an organization that she pretty much directed to buy land in the gorge, and it ended up acquiring some 20,000 acres in 90 different transactions. But over that time, Nancy and I grew very close. We used to play tennis together, and unbeknownst to me initially, she was one of the best women tennis players in the country. And you could see her drive in the way she played tennis. I mean, she always zeroed in on her opponent's weaknesses. I think she played with me for 3 years before she hit a ball to my forehand. She would. She was so consistent. She would run every single play down. She never gave any quarter. So it was, this great friendship developed over time.
And then, over a tennis court.
Exactly, over a tennis court. And then just, I had started out really, I didn't know the gorge that well when she hired me. So we would spend almost every day, it seemed like, but pretty much every day initially, going up and down the gorge with reporters or funders and donors. And she would explain its history. She would explain the threats to it. It was just a fascinating education. And out of that was born, our success in passing the National Scenic Area Act and our friendship.
I was going to say, it also sounds like another thing that was born was that you kind of fell in love with the gorge as well.
That's exactly right. And Nancy, I think to really enjoy a landscape, if you know a lot about it, you're that much more appreciative. So, we would go up in the gorge, we'd be in the Western Gorge, and we'd be looking at Steigerwald Lake, which is the entrance on the Washington side in the west. And she would explain how William Broughton sailed up in 1792 and declared all those lands that you could see for Britain, which makes it that much more interesting. But then when you learn that this was zoned heavy industry and on the cusp of being developed and would have been were it not for Russel, it makes it that much more interesting. And same thing on the Oregon side, where you cross the Sandy River and you see this beautiful expanse of delta that's now one of the most popular parks in the Columbia Gorge. And if you knew that, as Nancy explained, that Lewis and Clark overnighted there in 1806, and Clark wrote in his journals that he couldn't get any sleep because the noise was so horrid from hundreds of thousands of ducks and geese. Knowing that makes the landscape that much more interesting. And then when you learn and knew, because I was working with Russel then, that the state proposed a huge truck stop, 10 acres in size, stadium lights, right on the Sandy River Delta where Lewis and Clark slept, and which is the entrance to the gorge on the Oregon side, it makes your appreciation of that landscape that much more interesting.
Oh, isn't that the truth? Well, the thing that really hits me too is that, all of you and the people that were started this right before Nancy, because my understanding is she was invited to a picnic and she went to the picnic as a normal person and left the picnic as like a crusader. That's how it, if you read on the website for the gorge, they talk all about her.
That's right.
And so even the people that came right before her, I'm struck with their foresight. I always think of us as humans that one of our great weaknesses is that we just don't have a lot of foresight. We are in reactionary mode so often, oh, wait, the truck stop already went up. Now we have to save the wetlands, but to see all of you fight this fight to keep it from going there to begin with, I find that amazing.
Yeah, but you're absolutely right. It's that lack of foresight we as humans have that tends to be the real problem in protecting these large landscapes. So what Nancy would do would be to take people out one at a time, as I kind of referenced before, whether it was a reporter or a donor or a foundation head, and she would take them out and she could show them this beautiful, intact landscape. And then she could point to certain segments and say, okay, here there's an 83-lot subdivision that was just approved by Skamania County. Here a mile downstream is another 24-lot subdivision. And here on top of Cape Horn, which is one of Washington State's most important landmarks, is a 16-lot subdivision. So instead of those subdivisions, she used a variety of litigation, land acquisition, and then the federal legislation, not just to stop those subdivisions, but to create parks and to create trails where there had been none before.
Well, you know, and it's one of the things that for anyone that's driving down the road listening to this, if you haven't seen the Columbia Gorge, I want everybody to pause and go look at pictures, because I've been up there and I've only seen little bits of it. And until you really understand just how stunningly beautiful it is and varied and what an amazing space that it is that we have in this country, that's for me when I really, I just knew it was beautiful. I did not know such passion and fight had gone into protecting it the way it has. And when everybody, when you go see pictures and you see, then you'll go, ah, now I get it. I really get it.
Yeah, well, you knew more than I did. When I came out to go to law school in Portland, I had driven out from Chicago area and I had never heard of the Gorge. So suddenly, you know, I crossed Eastern Oregon and Eastern Washington, which is mostly a desert. And I thought I had taken a wrong turn because I was looking forward to seeing the lush greenery of the Pacific Northwest. So you knew more than I did, but you're right. The Gorge is one of our nation's most scenic and historic and recreationally and culturally important areas. It's 85 miles long. It averages about 5 miles across. And it's one of the few places in North America where you have a major river cutting through a mountain chain at sea level. So you go from sea level to mountains almost a mile high in just a matter of yards. And it's a place, as I learned, really of superlatives. It was formed by the world's largest lava flows millions of years ago. It was scoured by the world's largest floods starting 18,000 years ago. It included the world's largest salmon runs. We had salmon, 10 to 16 million salmon a year, swimming up the gorge, some as large as 100 pounds and 4 feet wow. long. And it was, you know, it includes a rainforest with annual precipitation of 100 inches and a desert with precipitation of less than 10 inches. It contains some of the nation's most scenic and historic lands. A lot of people feel the oldest continuously occupied site in North America is Celilo Falls, which was a center of Native American life in the Pacific Northwest. I mentioned Lewis and Clark. They spent 37 days in the gorge on their journey down and then up the Columbia. It includes some of the most dangerous part of many immigrants' journeys during the Oregon Trail in the 1830s and 40s, the first paved highway in the Pacific Northwest. And now, you know, it's a politically complex area. I had talked about 2 states, 6 counties, 2 national forests, et cetera, et cetera. And it's now got the largest and most complex national scenic area in the country. So you're right. It's just a remarkable sight, and no description can do it justice. You have to see it.
Well, you know, the thing that strikes me so much, and one of the reasons that I said in the intro to this conversation, you know, and I told you before we hit record that every now and then you read about somebody and like it literally hurt my heart that I never got to meet this woman. Yeah. She sounds so awesome. But the idea that she came to this with no advocacy experience, you know, this wasn't what she did. And to go from that to being so instrumental, you know, and she said herself, and you said on one of the websites that of course she did not do it by herself. However, so many of us are afraid to step out of what we know. She didn't step out of what she didn't know or did what she knew. She leapt out of when she just like leapt to a whole other planet.
So. Yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, she had no organizing experience, no advocacy, no fundraising. She said she had never met a politician until this effort. So wow. She just jumped in, you know, both feet first. And what she had going for her was she was incredibly smart. She was tough. She was tenacious. She wouldn't let anyone back her down. She would stand up. She knew the gorge backwards and forwards. She had a physical connection to it. She loved hiking. She loved swimming in the Columbia. She had an intellectual commitment to it or connection. She loved the history of the Northwest. John Yon, who got her involved, first met her at a slideshow she was doing of the wildflowers in the Columbia Gorge. You know, there are, I think, 800 species of wildflowers in the gorge, 16 found nowhere else in the world. And the slideshow would draw upon the Latin names of these wildflowers, named after Lewis, named after Clark, named after Thomas Nuttall. So it was this physical connection, this intellectual connection, and she had a real emotional connection too. And that was to the beauty of the gorge. And part of that was the wildflowers. And the other thing that Nancy had, and as I look back and did the research, that I could see other leaders back in 1960, 1930, 1950, where they had done some good things, but ultimately they failed. And I think they failed because more often than not, their ego got in the way. They ended up being more interested in kind of being seen as the head of the campaign than necessarily the success of the campaign. So that really differentiated Russel. And so while she didn't have any of the quintessential attributes that you think are necessary for protecting a large landscape like the gorge, she had all these other characteristics that made her in so many respects just the perfect choice.
Well, and you know, when you jumping back, when you talked about her as a tennis player, that was what I thought. It was like such great skills on the court for, like you said, drive and tenacity and never giving a quarter. You know, those obviously she brought them to this job. But so she was also treated pretty poorly. Her name was dragged through the mud. There were bumper stickers against her, right?
That's exactly right. I mean,
that not hurt her heart? That's what I want to know. Like that had to have hurt her heart some.
Well, you know, it really, I don't think it did. I mean, she was, one of her great talents, and this came from tennis, was her focus. And she was focused on, and she was very competitive too. So she was focused on prevailing in this fight. And the stuff that she considered peripheral, whether it was the bumper sticker saying "Save the Gorge from Nancy Russel," or it was the tires that were slashed at a congressional hearing in Stevenson, Washington, or it was death threats, all those were kind of peripheral. You know, not that she didn't, you know, think about it and take the necessary precautions, but you know, she didn't miss a beat. She had, as I say, death threats / tires, but it didn't alter what she did. She kept going out in the gorge. She kept taking people in the gorge, and she never backed off her positions one bit. So, and I guess that's another attribute that I didn't mention, and that's her courage. She was a really courageous person, but everything she was thinking about was, how do I protect the gorge? And everything else was kind of peripheral.
Well, I can hear the admiration you have for her. I can hear how much you care for her, that she was your friend. And my question for you, though, is how did you take the leap into actually writing a book about her?
Well, you know, it's a good question. And it was, I had been thinking about it for a while. And you know, I was, as you can tell, I was so inspired by her story. I also knew that most people didn't know the story. I was incredibly lucky. I had a front row, kind of behind the scenes look at how Nancy was able to accomplish what she accomplished. And I knew that I was one of the few people who could tell that story because of my background at Friends of the Columbia Gorge and the Trust for Public Land. I saw in real time what all these challenges were. And inevitably, they came down to the very last second, whether it was stopping development or purchasing a key property or even legislation, which really passed at the absolute last second. And President Reagan signed it, that, and it would have died of a pocket veto if he had waited a few more hours. But he was kind of forced to sign it, and sign it he did. So all that was just most people didn't know about. And I was worried if I didn't tell the story would eventually die. And I wanted people to know it because it's a great story. And it's really fun to tell. But I also wanted people to be inspired by Russell's story. And I think they are inspired by it. Certainly, I was inspired by it. And the people I talk to tend to be very inspired by it.
Oh, completely, completely. You know, because anything I want to do in this world that I think to myself, I have no idea how to do that. All I got to do is think back to this conversation and to this book, because that it's just that's just not an excuse anymore. You know, you learn on the fly. You just learn as you go. You know, that's what she showed you could do, you know, and affect real meaningful change.
That's exactly right. And you know, most of us who spend a lot of time outdoors have a place that we particularly value. And often that place can be threatened. And the lesson Russel taught us was that no matter how big, no matter how complicated, no matter what the forces are against you, you can prevail. And, you know, she was an amazing person, but she wasn't superhuman. You know, her skills were intelligence, toughness, you know, competitiveness, focus. And most of us have some of those skills and can employ them. And Nancy showed that if you employ them in this sort of situation, you can be successful and you can enact lasting change.
Well, I want to add one thing to that list of skills. She also seemed to have boundless, unstoppable, unendable or unending energy. Because I read this thing that says that she would work in the office, she would speak with reporters and donors, and then she would take them on a gorge tour every day. And then go home and do multimedia slideshows at night after cooking dinner for her family. And, I mean, that right there.
That's exactly right. And these were in the days when you did multimedia slideshows. That meant you were carrying 30, 40 pounds of equipment around with you. She had two projectors. And, you know, one of the smartest things I ever did as executive director of Friends of the Columbia Gorge was to not learn how to give that slideshow, because I think it would have exhausted me. So she did. And again, this probably comes from tennis and all the hiking she did, but she had unbelievable reservoirs of strength and energy that she would employ in her cause. And it made just a huge difference.
Well, you know, before we go, I do want to actually say one thing, though. So, because in all this research, yes, I came to just adore and think she was amazing and really regret not knowing her. However, one of the things that struck me is that I live near the Appalachian Trail. And on the show, we talk about the AT a lot because I have a lot of friends and, you know, and you reminded me that all the beautiful areas in this country have a story like this, and they have people that are standing up and protecting them. And we don't hear those stories. I know a lot of the AT stories because I'm here. I don't know the stories from the other places. And you're doing such a great service of sharing that view of what happens to places all over this country that need protected and they need heroes. Or in her case, she rose.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And they need constant vigilance too. I just read a great book about George Bird Grinnell and about protecting Yellowstone Park. And, you know, those of us who go to Yellowstone, we see this amazing, beautiful area. And of course, it's protected. There would be no reason why you wouldn't protect a place like that. But then you read about the background, and even a place like Yellowstone was very, very difficult to protect and took years and years. And for the first decade or two, there was a real question about whether the geothermal features would survive, whether the bison herds would survive there. And so it takes people, and it takes constant vigilance.
Well, you know, it's actually a quote that comes from you, that you said Nancy was the first one to point out that we cannot say that the gorge is saved.
Yeah.
Yeah. When I first read that a little bit, I was like, oh, ouch. But then I thought, no, these are never ending battles, never ending.
That's exactly right. I mean, she saved it from certain destruction in the 1980s. But some of the challenges we face today are very different. And there are always going to be these challenges. And unfortunately, there are always going to be people who benefit by, you know, chipping away at these incredibly important areas. So I think it was Brock Evans at National Audubon who said, you just eternal vigilance eternally applied. And I think that's exactly right, whether it's the Columbia Gorge or Yellowstone Park or our backyard.
Well, I did learn one more thing too when I was doing my research, and that, you know, she is such the face of this. And with you telling her story and you writing the book, you are sharing her with the world. And that's so amazing. However, in my research, another name came up over and over in terms of tireless work for the gorge, and that was Bowen Blair. And, you know, I think probably you will not be, you're not getting as much recognition, which, like you said, you know, the people that do it for their egos, they don't tend to succeed. But I wanted just to tell you that just in what little I've read, I see the work that you've done. And thank you. Thank you. Thank you. For those of us that love the beautiful wild places in this country, thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Anna. It's certainly been a labor of love. I can't imagine a more rewarding and fun career than I've had. And so much of that was getting to know people, and especially Nancy Russel. That just, you meet some of the best people doing this work and some of the most inspirational people.
Well, for everybody listening, I want you to run, do not walk, and buy the book. I've got all the links, of course, in the show notes, and I've got Bowen's biography. You can go see what he's doing, and I hope that you sell a million books, not just to make some money, but, you know, to share this story, and because what you are going to do is inspire other people to stand up and keep fighting for these spaces.
Well, I really hope so. Hope that I inspire people. I really do. But thank you so much, Anna, for saying that. It's greatly appreciated.
Well, thank you for being on the podcast. This has just made my heart just get bigger and bigger and bigger. And I really appreciate you coming on.
Well, thank you very much. And I appreciate everything you're doing with Trail Dames. I really do.
We're all fighting our good fight, aren't we?
We are.
All right. You take care, and we will talk again.
Okay. Thanks, Anna.
So in case you couldn't hear it, that was like a sigh. Because I don't really know what to do with that conversation we had. I was really moved to hear Nancy's story. And, you know, we hear a lot of amazing stories on this podcast, but I just keep going back to that idea. I love it when someone, doesn't matter that they don't know what they're getting into, doesn't matter if they have the education or the background or even the support system, but when someone just jumps in because they believe in something so much, I just think that those people are superheroes. Even though Bowen says she wasn't, I'm pretty sure she had to have a little bit of superhero blood in her. But I also think it makes me feel like I can do that. You can do that. Any of us can do that if we just are brave enough to take the leap. I also want to say you're all so jealous of me because after we stopped the recording, Bowen invited me to come up and go hiking sometime. And he said he would take me on some of his favorite trails in the gorge. I am totally taking him up on that. I hope you really enjoyed the interview. I can't wait to finish reading the book. And I know that you're going to love your copy too. So go order it. Now sit back for just a quick second. I'm going to share a couple of my own AT journal excerpts from you. I hope you enjoy them. And I just really appreciate you listening to the Trail Dames podcast. And I want to throw out another thank you to Mighty Blue, our producer, and the Hiking Radio Network. We're part of a stable of podcasts, and I couldn't be prouder. Oh, one more final thing. In case you don't know it, we now have t-shirts for all the podcasts that are available for sale. Go to hikingradionetwork.com and buy all the t-shirts, not just the Trail Dames one, which is particularly beautiful, but go buy them all and help support Mighty Blue and all the amazing things he's doing. Now, listen to the AT journals and then go hike. I'm gonna dance upon the September 15th. Well, today was a day in which the AT could not make up its mind as to what kind of trail it wanted to be. Several times I found myself talking to the trail saying, "All right, Sybil, what's it going to be? Make up your mind." Now, that won't make a bit of sense to some of the younger readers out there, but trust me, your parents will get it. The day started cool and damp, and I slowly broke down camp as the early morning mist started to dissipate. Two hikers passed my sight as I was packing, and I knew that I would have company on the trail today. When I left camp, the trail was cushioned by several inches of pine needles and duff. I had a nice, leisurely, level hike for the first bit, and I enjoyed it immensely. It was just the first of many types of trail I would see today. Rocks? Well, sometimes there were none, and sometimes they littered the path. Then, near the end of my hike, the rocks started to resemble the White Mountains. Luckily, the Boulder Student section was fairly short, so I didn't stress too much over it. However, the one thing that all of the rocks had in common was that they were covered with a green slick of algae, making for some entertaining moments of trail dancing. Trees? They were most everywhere, of course, but different ones took over the trail at different times. The birch were the most prolific, and at times you could see great big curls of birch bark scattered through the woods. At other times, so many trees had fallen that the trail was more like a jungle gym than a path. I went through old forest and young forest, through valleys and over the ridgetops. Interspersed with the woods were giant fields of grass and flowers, several new kinds of styles, and yards of bog bridges. Can you see why I called the trail Sybil? But it did make the day interesting, and it kept me occupied for the 9 hours that I hiked. So back to those bog bridges, though. Remember back when you were in middle school and they showed you that film in science called How a Pond Becomes a Meadow? It's all about how the dead plant and animal life builds up on the bottom of the pond and becomes fertile ground for more plant life, which sooner or later takes over the pond. Well, today the trail went through several of these pond-meadows, and it was the neatest thing. Lots of man hours, and I'm sure lots of money, have gone into building these wooden boardwalks so that we can walk through the area without killing the plant life. And I'm happy to say, without getting our boots wet. When you walk over the bridges, you can see a billion different types of plants growing all around you, some taller than my head. And underneath it all is dark water. The area has the most organic smell you can imagine. And hundreds of birds are nested in the plants. They complete the sensory experience with all their bird calls. This was my favorite part of the trail today. It ended up raining on me on and off all day long, and as a result of all the moisture, the trail took on this primal, mysterious feel. The algae-covered rocks and the slick mud turned the whole walk into a trip through a rainforest, with me sidestepping rainbow-colored salamanders and looking out for moose the whole time. Unfortunately, no moose sighting today, although I did see a fair number of footprints. Maybe tomorrow. The sun was setting when I finally arrived at the cabin, and I was pleased to see the two hikers from this morning were already there. We had leapfrogged a couple of times during the day, so I already knew that Jonathan and John were easygoing and fun. Portuguese, one of the hikers I had met at the outfitters in town, was here as well, so we all sat down to cook dinner and hang out for a while. Traveling Jack, he's the caretaker for the cabin, entertained us all with stories of the area, and we all threw out our tallest tales of the things we had seen on the AT. Several hours later, my sides aching with laughter, I excused myself to settle into my bunk. This has been a great day. However, just for the record, I do still miss Pumpkin. She would have loved these guys and this place. I hope the White Mountains are treating her well, and I can't wait to hear about her adventures in a few days. Love, Mudbutt. September 16th. After we all settled down to bed last night, the heavens opened up, literally. I have never heard it rain so hard for so long, and I woke repeatedly, feeling really grateful for the roof over my head. Now, don't get me wrong, cuddling up in my sleeping bag, snugly ensconced in my tent, it's a great way to ride out a storm, but having to deal with all that wet gear the next morning, it's a pain. As it was, I got to hear the rain through the screen sides of the cabin while everything I owned stayed nice and dry. In the middle of the storm, I heard another hiker arrive and figured that it must be Portuguese friend, Prozac. Sure enough, there he was, sitting at the table when Traveling Jack called us all to breakfast. We sat down to blueberry pancakes and enjoyed a feast fit for a thru-hiker. The food was wonderful, but it was far outweighed by the company. Jonathan, John, Prozac, Portuguese, Traveling Jack, and myself continued our storytelling from the night before. And once again, I excused myself from the group with aching sides from laughter. This warm camaraderie of fellow hikers has made even richer by the wet green woods, the bright blue sky, and the cool autumn air. The porch of the cabin kept us dry from the dripping trees as we all created one of those wonderful AT memories that I will carry home from my journey. After breakfast, Jonathan took me over into the woods to show me an American chestnut. The Upper Goose Pond cabin, like many of the older buildings we have seen on this trip, is made of this wood, and I was under the impression that there are no more American chestnuts living. Jonathan explained to me that baby trees grow all of the time, and that I had passed hundreds of them. Unfortunately, the blight that has killed all of the adult trees doesn't allow the young chestnuts to grow up before it kills them. When he showed me the tree, I did recognize it as one I had seen constantly on this trip. It did give me hope that if researchers can find a cure for the blight, the tree itself still exists so it can regenerate itself. Well, despite all the laughter and the learning, I finally tore myself away from the group and packed my stuff up. My hike today would be fairly short, but the journey to get back to the car could take all day, so I had to get moving. The woods were fresh and new from all the rain, and for the first time in my entire trip, I was the first person out on the trail. You might think that being the first person out of the shelter in the morning is an invigorating way to start the day, watching the sun come up and listening to the birds sing. However, the Native Americans have a name for this hiker. It is she who eats spiderwebs. Yep, I ate spiderwebs all the way up the trail. All those little industrious little spiders worked hard all night long, and I came along and I just ruined it. What I really want to know is how they know exactly how high off the trail to build their webs so that they hit me directly across the face. Now I remember why I usually lag around camp in the mornings. After hiking a couple of miles, I heard the sound of traffic getting louder, and I looked down and I saw the bridge crossing the Massachusetts Pike. For 10 years, I have driven to New Hampshire to go to bow making class, and for 10 years, I drove under the footbridge built especially for the Appalachian Trail. For 10 years, I would honk, regardless of whether or not there were hikers on the bridge. And for 10 years, my eyes would well up and I would think, someday. Well, today was my day. Before I crossed the bridge, I wrote a note to my hiker friends from the night before that said, look where you are. Enjoy this, because as far as AT moments go, this is a big one. I placed it under a rock in the middle of the trail, and I walked out onto the bridge to take my place with all the other thru-hikers that have come before me. If you drove under the AT bridge today and you looked up at the right time, you would have seen a woman in a blue shirt with a great big backpack, waving her hiking poles wildly in the air as a huge grin split her face in two. As I did the dance of the real woman on that bridge, the sounds of car horns rained down around me. And yes, as far as AT moments go, it was a big one. The rest of my hike was uneventful, and by the time my heart had stopped beating a mile a minute, I had come to the highway leading into Lee. I was 5 miles from the nearest bus stop, but had a problem. I didn't have a ride. Now, this is the time when most thru-hikers just throw their thumb out and hitchhike. But being by myself, that just didn't feel very smart. Using a tried and true rule that I have already used several times this summer, I thought to myself, would I want one of my students to do this? The answer was a resounding heck no. So I kept my arms by my side and I started walking. There was a lot of construction on the highway and all the workmen and the police greeted me as I walked by. The next hour and a half went by quickly, and as I came into town, I found myself in front of an old convenience stash package store. The sign said that they made sandwiches, so I went in to check it out. 5 minutes later, I was sitting on the front stoop of the store, boots off, eating a bologna sandwich and drinking a liter of Gatorade. I looked down and I realized that this is who I had become, a person completely comfortable and completely at home in the woods, at home on the highways of this country, and at home with myself. Yep, as far as AT moments go, it was a good one. Love, Mud Butt.
You gotta suffer.